Crimes Against History by Antoon De Baets, read by Nigel Anthony. To Georges Lapierre, 1886 to 1945. A French teacher, peace educator, and member of the resistance who began writing a primary school history textbook following his imprisonment by the Gestapo in March 1943. And, carrying the manuscript with him day and night, continued the project in the concentration camps of Sachsenhausen, Natzweiler-Struthof, and finally Dachau, where he died of typhus on the 4th of February, 1945. The story is told in the memoirs of Edmond Michelet, Rue de la Liberté, Dachau, 1943 to 1945. Introduction. The integrity of history. Some stories are waiting to be told and are meant to be told. Things happen, and later you investigate them and think, this is worth a story. That is how some of the best works of history are born. Other stories are waiting to be told, but are not meant to be told. Things happen, but from the start, they are mixed with lies, erasure, secrecy, and denial. They seem to need concealment. Welcome to the world of censorship, the stories that were never meant to be told. Investigating such stories is difficult. How to look into things that are not there anymore, not because of the natural passage of time, but because of malignant intervention. Stories become puzzles. They multiply. We want to hear the censored stories in uncensored versions, and, in addition, we want to hear the stories of how and why they were censored in the first place. This book contributes to the history of the censorship of history. It takes a look behind the curtains where censors cut stories only to paint a polished version of the past that suits them. George Bernard Shaw once wrote, "Censorship ends in logical completeness when nobody is allowed to read any books except the books nobody reads." Exposing the censorship of history is the beginning of its end. Approaching the normal. What is the censorship of history? The legal definition usually encompasses restrictions on views about the past before they are expressed, pre-censorship, plus all those restrictions on views about the past after they are expressed that engender chilling effects and disproportionate sanctions, post-censorship. The characterization that I use in my book starts from this legal definition, but often goes beyond it. In this broader sense, censorship of history is the systematic control over historical facts or opinions and their exchange, imposed by or with the connivance of the government or other powers. The typical form of censorial control is suppression. Once delineated as such, it opens up a research field of generous amplitude. One can, for example, survey the history works in a country or region during a given span of time, and then analyze political and other non-scientific forms of control over it. Or one can pick an historical topic, for example, colonialism, and observe how former metropoles censored certain views on their past as colonizers. One can also take a sector, for example, history education, archives, or archaeology, and trace if and how inappropriate political or other influences are at work. All this we can call classical studies in the censorship of history. They give us useful insights into the numerous ways in which historical writing is subjected to and twisted by non-scientific forces. More than once, these forces tend to operate invisibly in the interstices of science, and often those subjected to them do not report on their experience out of fear or shame. Without knowledge of them, we get a seriously distorted overall view. Sometimes the figure of history censorship is less self-evident. Take defamation, the attack on reputation. Individuals who see themselves or their relatives described in biographies or other historical works can come to the conclusion that their reputations are harmed by the way in which they're portrayed and sue the authors for defamation. As reputation is a strong right, it is incorporated into the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. This is a seemingly fair procedure. On careful scrutiny of the available defamation cases, and there are plenty, it appears, however, that defamation charges are often exploited as powerful tools in the hands of public figures, especially political leaders, to punish historians who write critical biographies about them and to deter others who attempted to do so likewise. The thesis could even be defended that the defamation trial, including the threat to sue for defamation, is the second most widely used tool to censor history worldwide, after dismissal. Often defamation trials are but forms of malicious prosecution and censorship in disguise. Whoever sees this never forgets it. There are other less common forms of history censorship. Take international censorship, the attempts of some states to censor unwelcome versions of their history circulating abroad. The history of international censorship has yet to be written. Many states deny entry to foreign scholars who contaminate domestic scholars with their historical views, and a few powerful states even intervene in the internal affairs of other states with the support of diplomacy, funds, propaganda, and pressure to change historical views expressed abroad that do not conform to their official self-image. Another way to approach censorship is to look at its edges. Is all suppression of information really censorship? Censorship has many grey areas. Take self-restraint. We all practice it because we know that freedom of expression, even if it is universal, is not absolute. But at which moment does self-restraint morph into self-censorship? Self-censorship is the ultimate goal of any censorship apparatus. Where it is successfully established, intimidation and fear spread so effectively that external control becomes superfluous. It is the widest spread but least visible form of submission. They call it the scissors in the head. Take hate speech bans. To what extent can hate speech bans be called legally tolerated and socially accepted censorship? Or take history textbook moratoria. Many countries that in their recent past have known genocide or similar large-scale attacks on the human rights of their citizens suspend the teaching of recent history altogether, because in their divided societies, no agreement can be reached on the best way to present and explain the past human rights catastrophe. When, in such post-conflict situations, do moratoria on history textbooks constitute a wise policy measure, and when censorship? To study censorship also at its edges is unavoidable. Approaching the extreme. Other more unusual perspectives can be highlighted in the study of history censorship. Sometimes censors are ordered to replace the patient job of controlling individual historical productions by more drastic measures. When they resort to disproportionate sanctions and extreme solutions, they do not simply suppress individual historical messages, but destroy their vehicles or even murder their producers. Censors become hecklers, killers, and avengers. These extreme acts transcend the common understanding of what the censorship of history is. They can only be called crimes. Crimes against history. Surprisingly, these draconian forms that replace the control of historical messages by the brutal destruction of either the messages or their producers are not well studied. A tentative definition would be, crimes against history mean any of the following acts when committed as part of a widespread or systematic attack pursuant to or in furtherance of a state or non-state policy. The assassination and disappearance of history producers. Public personal attacks on history producers through hate speech, defamation, and malicious prosecution. intentional destruction of cultural heritage. Disinformation, including genocide denial and censorship of history. Crimes against history are abuses of history that constitute violations of human rights. In particular, they violate the right to life, the right to a fair trial, the right to free expression, the right to equality, and the rights to culture and science. I studied some of the elements of the crime against history as standalone phenomena in the past: hate speech, defamation, genocide denial, and naturally the censorship of history. The emphasis of this book will be on the remaining elements, the worst, in order to grasp the umbrella concept of crimes against history in its entirety. Part 1, Kill Switch, tells the tragic story of the historians and archivists who were assassinated or disappeared for political reasons, chapters 1 and 2. It reflects upon the dramatic occasions when top leaders in a country, the heads of state and government, have publicly attacked selected historians or other history producers for their critical attitudes, often by spreading hate messages about them, defaming them, or unjustly prosecuting them. Chapter 3. It also analyzes the motives behind the strange iconoclastic urge of some state political regimes and non-state entities, demonstrated recently in Mali, Syria, and Iraq, to abolish the past by intentionally destroying the cultural heritage of their perceived enemies. Chapter 4. Finally, it investigates the problem whether fake news and its corollary, disinformation, are lethal threats to history producers. I argue that they are. Chapter 5. If censorship resorts to such extreme measures, the past is literally under deadly attack. Crimes against history are being committed. It is the kill switch. In part 2, Fragile Freedom, I reverse angles and try to identify situations in which censorship organizes its own funeral. Censorship has chilling effects, certainly, but it also generates other effects, such as the backfire effect. It possesses the curious, self-defeating tendency to highlight what it wishes to hide. Often the censorship apparatus is clumsy or simply imperfect, and has its gaps and interstices. And the historians it targets invent techniques to evade it, for example, by introducing historical analogies. When, how, and why do historians speak about the past to comment on the present? Chapter 6. Moreover, in many other creative ways, historians have tacitly or openly resisted the assault of power on the representations of the past. Chapter 7. Everywhere, history producers have exploited the smaller or larger margins of freedom, often at great risk. Only history untainted by breaches of its integrity can perform its vital functions for present and future generations. Tips for the listener. The structure, logic, and conclusions of the individual chapters are largely self-explanatory, but a few general tips should preferably be kept in mind to understand some of the book's core choices. All cases presented in this book come from my worldwide database on the censorship of history spanning the period from 1945 until today. Occasionally, I go further back in time to illustrate some point, in Chapter 6, for example, or make some comparisons, in Chapter 1, for example. In passing, it allows me to demonstrate that the censorship of history is a phenomenon of all times and places. All chapters are built on empirical data, bearing in mind the maxim that theories are good servants but bad masters. I tried to root my theoretical reflections in these empirical data as much as possible, rather than the other way around. I should also warn of a bias in my data. Due to the proliferation of human rights awareness in recent years, more information is generally available for the 1990s and 2000s, which means that the book has an almost unavoidable present-centered bias. Furthermore, Although famous historians are often less representative of trends in a given country than lesser-known historians are, they typically arouse more interest, and their cases are better documented. They are, therefore, overrepresented. All chapters have an international, comparative, and multifactorial design. I must beg for some understanding here. Readers who inspect first or solely the examples within their own expertise or country are warned. They may likely experience the well-known but perhaps unavoidable disappointment that checking familiar examples in large overviews entails. The international comparative approach is a genre with its own challenges. Its cost may be a certain lack of vertical depth. Its benefit, the prospect of gaining horizontal insights impossible to harvest from single case research. In the book, I talk a lot about democracy and dictatorship. In distinguishing between both, I follow, as in much else, the views of the United Nations. According to the United Nations, a democratic society is a society that recognizes and respects the human rights set forth in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. They speak about consolidated democracies, emergent or new democracies, and non-democratic countries. I further add that the latter category comprises dictatorships, usually regimes in which a small group illegitimately holds power over the state with backing from the military. Typically, two types of dictatorships are distinguished: authoritarian regimes that use force to impose their rule and repress dissent, and totalitarian regimes that, in addition, try to impose control on all aspects of life, including the private sphere. The history of historical writing has its privileged and sometimes surprising perspectives. The study of the censorship of history offers such an unexpected vantage point. If historical writing is a photograph, then the censorship of historical writing is its negative, its dark side. It is my conviction that the study of the censorship of history is an integral part of the backfire effect of censorship. In unexpected ways, the apocalyptic transformations of censorship and its escape route studied in this book enlighten the nature of history as a craft as much as straightforward censorship studies or studies in the philosophy of history. At the same time, it fills many essential gaps in traditional histories of historical writing. Crimes against history attack the core of historical writing, its integrity. Part 1. Kill Switch. 1. Historians killed for political reasons. The Grand Scribe wrote, "Cui Zhu assassinated his ruler. Cui Zhu put him to death." The scribe's younger brothers continued to write the same thing, and so two more persons were killed. Another younger brother again wrote it, whereupon Cui Zhu desisted. Excerpt from a chronicle explaining how three scribes were killed after recording regicide in Qi in 548 BCE. These are the earliest known cases of historians killed for political reasons. The most radical way to censor history is to kill its producers. It is a practice as old as history itself. If history is so dangerous that it seems to justify the death of its producers, then the reasons why that history was so shocking must be intriguing. Some examples may suffice to illustrate this. In 1938, after 8 years of imprisonment, the economic historian Nikolai Kondratiev was executed by firing squad on the orders of Joseph Stalin. In the mid-1920s, Kondratiev had developed a theory of long-wave economic cycles which deviated from Soviet dogmas. He was skeptical about the inevitable collapse of capitalism and critical about the role of rapid industrialization and collectivized agriculture as advocated by Stalin. This cost him dismissal and charges of counter-revolutionary activity. and defamation of the USSR, and it eventually led to his death. Only 50 years after his execution was Kondratiev rehabilitated. Chinese historian Jian Bozan fared no better. In 1968, during the Cultural Revolution, he committed suicide in prison together with his wife. He had been imprisoned, among other reasons, for defending the concession theory. According to Jian, the ruling class, when confronted with peasant rebellion in history, was often forced to make concessions to restore the established order. This theory thus held that there had not always been a class struggle in Chinese history. This aroused the wrath of Mao, who personally attacked Jian in late 1965 for questioning the role of class struggle in history. It was the first step of a persecution that led to his death. Kondratiev and Jian died on account of state violence. While Syrian archaeologist and historian Khaled al-Assad was the victim of non-state violence. A director of the Department of Antiquities and Museums in the ancient Syrian town of Palmyra for 40 years before retiring in 2003, he was detained by Islamic State militants in that town at age 81 in 2015 and interrogated for over a month about where his collaborators had hidden saleable artifacts. When he refused to reveal their location, he was beheaded in front of a crowd at a square in Tanmur, the modern town next to Palmyra. His body was first left on the ground, then suspended from a traffic light, his severed head underneath it. A handwritten placard tied to his body contained six charges. He served as the director of idolatry at Palmyra. He was an apostate. He was loyal to the al-Assad regime. He represented Syria at infidel conferences. He visited Iran, and he communicated with the security services. His body was then taken to Palmyra's archaeological site and hung from one of the Roman columns, while Islamic State supporters circulated online photos of the body. Kondratiev, Jian, and al-Assad paid with their lives for their historical opinions. Properly speaking, the study of history producers who died for reasons related to their interest in the past deserves an individual approach so as to leave a monument for each of them. Unfortunately, I cannot provide such a tribute here. I rather present a synthesis of the phenomenon. A global survey of all cases in which historians, or to be more precise, history producers, were killed for political reasons throughout history, should enable us to gain an idea of the magnitude of the phenomenon of history censorship through physical elimination. With such a survey, I want to achieve three goals: to offer an overview of regime types that use the tool of censoring history by killing its producers, to develop a thesis about why this strategy was applied, to look for independent corroboration of this thesis. Demarcation problems. My survey requires solutions for three demarcation problems. The first involves the concept of political killings. A formidable obstacle to a study of political killings is its peculiar epistemology. In some cases, political murders occur in the open in order to set an example and intimidate, as in the al-Assad case. But usually they're shrouded in secrecy, as in the Kondratiev and Jian cases. Many political murders go unrecorded as political murders, or even as murders. This implies that knowledge of the basic facts and circumstances of these murders often lack exact names of victims, for example, or exact dates of their deaths. Or, to name another difficulty, enforced disappearances, in the majority of cases, are political murders of which the dead bodies are not found. The problem of acquiring reliable knowledge hampers the investigation, in particular if we want to know, as in the case here, whether the murders were political in the first place, and what motives lay behind them. There is, however, also another side to it. Non-natural deaths spark enduring curiosity. Important information may emerge even decades after the fact. For example, in 1984, American historian Malcolm Kerr was assassinated in Beirut by Hezbollah on the orders of the Iranian government. As the president of the American University of Beirut, he was a high-profile target. A lawsuit brought against the perpetrators almost 2 decades after the murder revealed crucial new details. In addition, Kerr's daughter later wrote a book about the murder based on these court records and previously secret intelligence. I included 2 types of political murder in my research. First, all those deaths that were the result of direct and intended operations by state and non-state agents, such as extrajudicial assassinations, improper judicial executions, and enforced disappearances. Secondly, all political killings that were the indirect but immediate result, intended or not, of persecution, as in cases of deaths in prisons and camps, deaths following ill treatment, and suicides due to severe political pressure or impending deportation. In spite of crucial distinctions between all these types of deaths, and although, strictly speaking, only extrajudicial assassinations are political killings, I will subsume them all under the single heading of political killings here. History producers who did not match this criterion were excluded. For example, those who received death threats but escaped, or those who survived assassination attempts, those who were sentenced to death but survived, those who were sentenced to life imprisonment but released before they died, unless they died as a demonstrable result of this imprisonment, those who were abducted but reappeared alive. Likewise, other cases were also excluded. History producers who were the victims of non-political crimes, those who became casualties either as soldiers or citizens in times of war or revolution, those whose deaths were related to their persecution only remotely, and those who committed suicide, for example, by self-immolation, for political symbolic reasons without having been specific targets of persecution. A second demarcation problem deals with the term history producers, a wider one than the term professional historian. When the aims are to persecute, to set an example, and to control the interpretation of the past, the killers do not necessarily make fine distinctions between professional historians and others dealing with the past. With typical crudeness, censors and killers perceive dangers irrespective of the professional qualifications of the victims. Therefore, a flexible definition of history producers is needed. It includes, on the one hand, the professionals and trainees in the historical sector in the broad sense. That is, historians, appellation contrôlée, history teachers, cognate professions, such as archivists, archaeologists, art historians, and so on, but also history students. On the other hand, there are those who have no formal historical education and yet produced historical works, such as historical novelists, directors of historical films, and journalists or politicians with historical output. The difference between both types is often unclear anyway, because there is much overlap and because the title of historian is not legally protected. Anyone can appropriate the title of historian or can be called by others an historian with impunity. History producers, then, are all those involved professionally or otherwise in the collection, creation, or transmission of history. The last demarcation problem relates to the motive for the killings. Often the motive was multi-interpretable. In other cases, there was not enough information to link a case to a particular motive. My approach identifies 4 layers of motives. History producers were killed because they were members of the category of history producers, because they were members of the category of intellectuals or academics, because they were members of the category of journalists, human rights defenders, or political activists, because they were members of a specific national, racial, ethnic, or religious group. Combinations between these categories were possible. I will call any of the preceding reasons of death a political reason. I'm interested most in the first, history-related category, deaths inflicted for reasons mainly or partly related to history or to dealing with the past. But I need the remaining three categories to estimate the relative importance of the history-related reasons. Population and sample. Cases must be explored with these demarcations in mind. The database, hereafter the population, covers the span from the dawn of time to 2017 and contains 428 history producers killed for political reasons. Political murders of history producers. Population from ancient times until 2017. From ancient times until 1899, 49 deaths, or 11.4% of the population. 1900 to 1944, 154 deaths, or 36%. 1945 to 1999, 174 deaths, or 40.7%. 2000 to 2017, 51 deaths, or 11.9%. Total, 428 deaths, or 100%. Sample for 1945 to 2017. 132 deaths, or 30.8% of the population. 58.7% of the segment, 1945 to 2017. This list is the product of a systematic and large-scale search over a decade. Is 428 a high or low number? To answer this question, a preliminary warning that will reoccur throughout this analysis must be made. The statistical basis of my observations is subject to the law of small numbers, meaning that it is hazardous to quickly generalize from the low frequencies per country and even from the overall total. This is an important difference with those who analyze the plight of journalists. Whereas the professions of journalism and history have important overlaps in terms of content, namely contemporary history, in terms of numbers of victims, they are incomparable. It suffices that tomorrow, a hitherto unknown execution list identifying victims by names and professions emerges from the police archives of, for example, a middle-sized dictatorship, to completely overhaul the picture for that country, its place in the ranking, and consequently, the entire interpretation based on it. Extrapolation of the findings to previous centuries should be avoided in light of the huge variation in political regimes over time and place. The impact of systematically gathered but randomly available data distorts any seemingly robust conclusion. All results of the present analysis are therefore tentative. The answer to the question, why then carry out such vulnerable research in the first place, is simple. It gives at least an impression. Before, we had none. It is a first exploration in a completely unmapped field. When we compare the killing of history producers with other, more conventional tools to censor history, it is plain that in no country were killings the most important or most representative persecution tool. Even if it was obviously effective in single cases because of elimination and deterrence effects, even if it played a relatively important role at certain moments, and even if the numbers of political murders in given countries or periods are sometimes clearly representative for wider repression patterns, its overall impact was always inferior to the effects of classical and wider spread censorship instruments such as the ban on works or the dismissal of authors. It is not immediately clear under which conditions political assassinations are comparatively more frequent. Nonetheless, even if its quantitative impact, its elimination effect, is almost always small, its psychological impact, its deterrence effect, is almost always devastating. Given the various demarcation problems and the strict inclusion criteria discussed above, the population is clearly only a partly consolidated database with many gaps and unknown numbers of false positives. Although scores of lists of political deaths circulate, for example, as appendices to Truth Commission reports, most unfortunately do not specify the professional details of the victims. In-depth research may thus reveal the occurrence of new cases in countries mentioned here or others, throwing fresh, perhaps radically different, light on the trends reported here. A further problem is the shifting boundary of the concept of historian over space and time. The more one moves away from the present, and from countries with firm historiographical traditions, the less obvious and the more anachronistic is the classical definition of the historian as a professional who methodically studies the past. This problem is only partly compensated by the fact that post-1945 sources tended to include a rich variety of information from human rights NGOs, whereas pre-1945 cases and certainly pre-1900 cases were mainly drawn from scholarly sources about historical writing only, thus usually including undisputed cases of established or at least well-known historians. All these observations lead me to conclude that a population of 428 can be regarded as far too low. Slightly more than one-tenth of all political murders took place before 1900, a bit more than one-third between 1900 and 1944, and more than half from World War II until 2017. The period 2000 to 2017 alone comprises more than one-eighth of all deaths. The explanation for the steep rise after 1900 is partly found in the huge number of authoritarian or totalitarian regimes in the first half of the 20th century, at least 16 in Europe alone. However, democracy was hardly the rule before the 20th century either. Another reason could be that the rising numbers reflect the worldwide professionalization of history and the prospering demography of the historical profession in the 20th century. For the period after 2000 to 2005, the previously unknown phenomenon of the citizen historian, the person blogging about history, should perhaps be taken into account. From this population, a sample was extracted for this study, given a time span of centuries, the temporal asymmetry just noted, and our purpose to identify regime types that use the political murder as a censorship tool, the sample was taken from the most recent population segment, covering the years from 1945 to 2017. In addition, countries and regimes with numbers of deaths lower than 5 were excluded from the sample in an attempt to eliminate arbitrary results and the crudest of distortions. Most importantly, the units of analysis are not countries but regimes that exercise their powers within these countries. Thus, the sample includes only regimes or coherent series of regimes that were responsible for the deaths of at least 5 history producers. In some countries, the deaths were distributed over relatively large stints of the regime's life. In others, they were compressed into one particular time span, in which repression was usually at its peak. The sample contains 132 deaths distributed over 14 regimes in 13 countries. Compared to the population, these 14 regimes were by themselves responsible for a little less than one-third of all political deaths of history producers in world history, and for almost 60% of all deaths in the period between 1945 and 2017. 3 regimes almost met the sample criteria. When East Pakistan became Bangladesh, 4 historians were kidnapped by a death squad and assassinated during the 1971 Independence War. 2 communist regimes were responsible for the deaths of at least 4 history producers: North Korea from the 1950s until 1979, and Afghanistan in 1978 to 1988. Political murders of history producers, sample specifics. 1945. Nazi Germany.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.